Hey everyone, it's Ed with Slow Car Fix, and today I'm working on my 57 Chevy truck, as I have been, and working on the 6-liter LS swap, tying up some loose ends, making some connections, installing the electric dash, the fancy Dakota Digital dash. Stick with me, and stick around till the end, because I sold a car. Okay, so I am at the stage where I'm trying to sort things out to get it ready to run. I have to do the breather. I hooked up my heater hoses yesterday. Even though I'm doing something with the heater in the cab, I still need to have them connected so I can put coolant in it. I have my lower rad hose. I have to put coolant in it. I got some coolant. I have to secure this somehow because it's kind of flopping around, and I want this extra piece of rubber that I've got here secured somehow, so this bolt here on the shroud isn't jamming into my radiator hose. The breather, I have sort of an idea of what I'm going to do, so I had to do this first. The other thing that I'm working on, and I have been working on, is the transcooler lines. I've been flaring, trying to get better with my flares. I've done lots of tube bending and compression fittings and stuff at work, but I have never really spent much time flaring. So fortunately, my buddy Richard was pointing some things out to me yesterday. And yeah, so these lines go in the transmission. I have fittings that I'm going to, because these are kind of a special flare that pops into the transmission. I have fittings that I'm going to put in between, and then I'm going to make 3/8 lines that come in and they go to this spot here on the radiator where it's got a built-in transcooler. So I gotta do that. I have the shifter is done-ish. I still have to, I haven't really been in the cab much. I gotta pull this back in the cab. I gotta pull that back in the cab. I still have the cruise control wires that I'm procrastinating on, but I have a plan for that. And the big thing that I have left, apart from doing the floor patch, is I got to do this Dakota Digital dash, which I don't think is a huge job, and that's the things I need to run it. And then plug some wires, which are here. So I have to do that. So lots of little odds and ends, and what I'm trying to do is sort out these odds and ends and get it closer to being able to fire up. I had actually hoped that I was going to be able to fire it up later today, but I really don't see that happening. I got some other things going on, and I got to finish this odds and ends, and I don't want to rush. So I think I'll just maybe put that plan on hold and try and fire it up in a week or two and see how that goes. But do another video on the first start of this used engine that's been started a million times. It'll be the first start in here though, but I want to go through and make sure that I've secured all the line, like fuel lines and any bit of wiring that where I thought, oh, well, I'll tie wrap that later. I need to do all that. I need to get as much complete as I can. And, so that's what I'm going to work on. And I think that's what's going to be this video. It's going to be tying up loose ends and maybe into the digital dash. I'm not sure yet. So I'm going to continue on. Keep on keeping on with the transcooler lines. So that didn't go quite as planned, but job done anyways. My tube bender makes 90s that kink. Not criticizing anything, but maybe it's where it's made. It's just not great. Maybe I don't know how to use it, but I'm successful with the ones at work that are, now mind you, it's been a little while, but the ones at work aren't made in the same place, and they're a little better quality. So anyways, my bends didn't go as planned, so I improvised, and I made a 90 here. I had two successful 90s, and I did a single flare on the other end, and I used a high pressure transmission cooler line rubber. Those clamps, I'll show you. Look at it with the light. You can can see that goes down there, goes down there, and goes up and over where I think the exhaust is going to be. So it goes around as far away from the exhaust as possible. Now, I did leave the flare nuts on the lines on the trans end, and so that way, if I decide later this high pressure rubber hose that's good for 400 PSI is not going to do it for me, then I can run steel lines and rebend with a proper bender or get some help from somebody that knows what they're doing. And yeah, it's the way it goes. So now I did have to remove all my heater hose and my lower cooling hose to be able to run that. But it's the same thing as always. It's in layers, right? You have to do everything in layers, because in order to do the heater hoses, you have to have the transcooler hoses done first because they're lower. In order to do the lower rad hose, you have to have the transcooler hose done because that determines the routing of it. And then you also have to have the heater hoses done before I can get into the breather that's going to go over here and do some sort of funniness. So there's a lot of things, a lot of things. You have to really think about things when you're trying to stuff a 50-year newer engine into a 50-year older vehicle. So, yeah, I've got to take there's a fitting in the back of the intake manifold. This 6-liter had it from the pressure that went to the brake booster, went from the power steering pump. Originally, it was a hydro boost brake system. I'm not doing that. I've capped it on the power steering end. Actually, that's something I did do. I installed the power steering lines and capped the hydro boost power steering pump line vent thing. Hopefully that's good enough. I need to, what else do I need to do? So I need to pop the cap out of there, and then there's a little pop a cap, bust a cap. I need to take the cap out of the back of the manifold and put in this little short thing that is going to allow me to run a vacuum hose to this brake booster check valve. So I have brakes, that'd be good. So I have to do that. I have to do this breather setup. I still have a little bit of like the cruise control wiring that I was talking about before that I keep procrastinating on, and then I have to do some wire loom, all that sort of stuff. So lots of little things, it's slow, steady, it's happening. So I did a little off camera work, just plugging away bits and pieces here and there, because I haven't really had a chance the last little while to work at it steady and put a bunch of hours in. So I'll show you what's going on here now. And I think I'm gonna start with, start looking at the dash, pulling the dash out and doing the Dakota Digital dash install. Been looking forward to that, and that's kind of a big thing that I'd like to have done before I started up. Other than that, I need to spend some time going through things under the hood, but I did make some progress with the air breather. I kind of like how it turned out, so I'll show you what I have right now. Here's the it's looking more complete all the time. This is the stock breather, but I didn't use the box because the box doesn't fit. The box, when I put it here, runs into the battery. I didn't really want an open breather, but this is the breather that I have in the Malibu, and it works pretty good. So I think I just put a 90 degree elbow here, like a whatever this material is, elbow, put the breather there, the math. I just plugged it in for now, but I've got to do something with this because it's too long. I'd like to make, I see it sitting on my, because it comes down a long way. It's sitting on top of my radiator hose. I checked the hood closes and everything. So I'm going to make some sort of support that attaches to it. I don't know, somewhere it will be supported. But I just jammed it on for now just so I could get a look. I think that's pretty cool. I like it. I think it looks tidy. It's kind of got like this big goofy space here, but that's okay. So I still gotta put plugs in it and everything else. So I'll end up taking this all back off. I just wanted to look at it and see. Other than that, I think I mentioned I did the power steering hoses and I did the Transcooler hoses, that's all done. I got to support this somehow. I'm not really sure yet. You can see that like this is pretty close to the pulley here, but I don't know if factory it was rotated a little different or something. I don't know. I need to play with it a little bit, but I do like how it's going, and I think it's going to be good once I put a support on it. It does have a spot here to support, so I'm not sure what I could use to pick up that, some sort of bracket. Maybe I can make a bracket that comes out here and goes to this bolt here that holds the shroud on or something. Some sort of bracketry thing. Just so it holds it from moving it around, because it does move around a bit. And I don't, it's not going anywhere near the belt or anything, but I don't want it to. So, but I do like the way it looks. I like the 90 degree thing. I like the breather. I think it's going to be good. Just got to come up with some sort of way to fix it. It's not a big deal. I can make a bracket, but I'm going to look at the dash thing. Walking around in circles here. So this is the Dakota Digital dash. If you've watched any of my videos, I've showed you this a bunch of times already. I'm excited about this. It was a lot of money. But it's going to save me a bunch of time. This is the little thing. I haven't unboxed it yet. This is the little thing that everything's supposed to plug into. This is the OBD adapter that plugs this unit into the OBD port. So I don't have an OBD port. I got to do that. It's one of my things I got to do. So this is my interior again. I need to pull this dash out. I got to pull out the speedometer cable, a couple of things. And I've got my wiring here for my OBD. And then this is the port, the thing that's going to get plugged in. So I got to plug that in. And then I got a wire that goes to the VSS. Or no, that's not the VSS. What is that? The sender for the... what am I talking about? The sender for the fuel gauge. That's what I'm talking about. So I got to do that. This guy here, what does this say? It's a good thing. This is why I label things. That's the brake switch. And this one is something else that goes to this guy. And then I've got more wires in here that I got to connect to it. So I got to figure that out, hook that port up. I've got all the instructions that I've written for myself that I forgot already. But I think the first thing I got to do is pull that dash out, and maybe I can take this shifter off. I think this just comes off with just a pin. Just, yeah, I think it does. Just knock the pin out and then take this off, because I don't need two shifters. I've got one now. So I think I'm going to start on that stuff. Typical old car crap. Stuff's been messed with a million times. and then stuff has to come out, wiring has to go everywhere. These things here, what is this? Like this is all for the line lock, and I've got to look and see. So I ripped out all the wiring for the line lock. I ripped out everything for it. I don't care if I have line lock. What I do need to make sure is that for some reason, if it needs power to release the brakes, or like if it's power open or power closed, if it needs power to release the brakes, then I'm going to have to put power on it. But other than that, I don't really care. But these things should not be used. Like these are like an emergency thing, and this truck is like built with them. Not from factory by any means. And speaker wire to run a push button switch, this is just garbage. It's just shit. If you look underneath my dash of many wires, this is radio stuff. You know, you expect to see this stuff with radios, but like, look what it does. It leaves bare ends. It's just this is just not good. So I'm gonna have to replace that. Ideally you want to solder and heat shrink. I'm not fussy on whether or not I crimp and heat shrink in the cab, or if I solder and heat shrink in the cab. People like to solder and heat, like the real good attention to detail guys like to solder and heat shrink everywhere. I agree, anything outside of the cab should be soldered and heat shrunk. That's kind of my rule of thumb. Anything inside the cab, to me, I can use, if you use a proper crimping tool with proper crimps and you heat shrink it, it's fine. So I have to, like, this is, I'm assuming this is the interior light because it goes to these light bulbs. I'm assuming that this is like was feeding a light to this heat bezel and a bunch of crap. And it's all just daisy chained together with garbage. Speaker wire in here and whatever. So I got to go through and get rid of all this crap. I'm not sure if I'm doing that right now. I got to look and see what I need to feed stuff. So apparently this thing, when I looked at my instructions, my own instructions, it needs a ground, it needs positive, and it needs this blue wire that I run from my engine bay, and that's it. I think it needs ground in two places, actually. I think both these black wires get ground. I'm not sure. I got to look at the schematics the guy with the harness gave me. And then one of these wires gets power, 12 volt. I think constant 12. And so from the battery all the time, not ignition. And the other one goes to this wire that goes to the fuse panel. Or not to the fuse panel, to the harness that goes to everything. These things are everywhere. Garbage, garbage, garbage. Oh, I took out that big giant tack. I might put that in the Malibu or something, because I have other autometer gauges in the Malibu, but like this is all gonna be one unit. I don't need a giant sun of attack sitting there. However, this does leave an ugliness on my dash, so I might put like a cell phone holder or something, which is also gonna be ugly, but maybe less ugly. Either that, or I'll just like, in the typical fashion of this truck, I'll sticker it or something. I have my best stickers right here. That kind of sums it up. Oh yeah, and this one right here that says I'm broke, because after this truck probably will be. So what else did I do? I got rid of a bunch of crap. Still have more crap to get rid of. I'm just chugging away at it. I guess I should probably, this is the plug I got for the drive-by-wire pedal. I got to put that back in. I guess I should probably, looks more wire, start looking at what this new dash needs to feed it, because I'm assuming it's going to want, like, this might be signal light stuff, so I might have to power this up and look and see what comes on when I turn on the signal lights, if one of these flashes, because I'm assuming it's going to want some sort of signal from the signal lights to know when they're flashing. Yeah, I should probably put power on it and see what all I've cut loose. It's got the heaters over there, some speaker wire. It's not as bad of a mess as the Malibu. The Malibu, a lot of the problem with the Malibu was that I was fighting wiring that I did when I was a kid, like 20 years ago or something, screwing with it, and probably 25 years ago. And so I was fighting myself and my own mistakes. Now I'm fighting someone else's, so it's
I don't know which one's more frustrating. But yeah, so I'm going to do something with something. I'm not really sure what. Maybe I'll open that box up and see what I need to do.
Okay, it's been a few days. I have a very good looking cappuccino going. I have a drive-by wire pedal. I got to do continue on this wiring. It's been a busy week, so kind of had to walk away from it for a bit. There's a lot of instructions. This is the dash thing. There's a lot of crap in here. I think I've pulled out, I counted that I removed 18 of these little clippy guys from under the dash. And I think there's at least four more under there that I want gone. So I gotta do that. I have mounted this this box here for the gauges underneath my fuse panel. So that's kind of a good spot, I think. And then I still have to figure out where I'm gonna put this one. And obviously it can't be in the way of my hide and switch or anything like that. And this is the one that's gonna plug into my OBD port. And this is my OBD port. I'm not sure if I mentioned this already. I thought this was gonna be really hard to wire in some big giant pile of wiring, but really all it is I gotta give it power, two grounds, and one signal from my PCM. So that's nothing. So I just gotta figure out where I like it to be, because this is gonna be plugged into it for the majority of the time, unless I'm scanning. So I gotta figure that all out, where I'm gonna put that. My buddy Richard's coming over today to work on what is now his car. I guess I can talk about that when he's here. And yeah, I gotta make some progress here. Lots of stuff going on. It's you can't really tell by outside right now, but it is getting a little warmer here in Ontario, so that's good. I'm looking forward to getting this thing going. Once I'm done all that dash stuff, finish up a couple of things in here, I'll probably end this video and start another one on getting it ready to run, which is going to involve, you know, putting fluids in it, securing my air box, putting plugs and wires, all that kind of stuff. So stay tuned for some stuff with that, tying up loose ends, sorting out loose ends, that kind of thing. And then ultimately it has to go to the exhaust shop to get the exhaust mated from the where the manifolds are, the 6-liter manifolds. I've got to cut it off, and Greg, my buddy that has the shop, will do the exhaust sorcery to get it bent and connected. I don't think I'm going to add resonators to this one right now. It's got like Flowmaster mufflers on it. It's kind of loud, but it's a truck, so the mufflers are out back. My Malibu, I had a problem because the mufflers were underneath the car, so I had to do resonators to just make it not have drone. That's the one, well, probably the only downfall of these LS engines is that they don't sound as good. They also, I guess they don't look as good, but they don't sound as good, really. I guess that's open for interpretation and argument and discussion, but I don't think they sound as good as a carbureted engine. I found that when I was into Harleys, it was the same thing. The fuel-injected bikes didn't sound as good as the carbureted bikes, but I preferred to ride the fuel-injected bikes. Anyways, I gotta get that tied in. I've got a list, but big thing today is more wiring, and then probably a couple little things helping my buddy Richard work on his new, my old car. Okay, I've got a sort of sidebar here a little bit. This is the radio. Did I mention how much I hate these things? These things suck. I get it, when used properly, you know, in a jam for some sort of additional crap, they can be handy, especially like when you got like a harness like down here and you just want to splice into it. But like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of them right here. And I've already, like I said, I've removed 18 already. This is one wire, this wire here, that goes from the light here and daisy chains to the light for the dashes. But instead of you running one piece of wire, they jumpered, like, I don't know what they were doing. It's really a mess. So, and then this is radio stuff. Like, why is there wires that are just speaker wires twisted together and not taped? I don't know. This is typical old car stuff. I don't know why it surprises me. But what I'm going to do, because this entire bundle of crap is radio stuff. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to lose this entire bundle of crap by just removing the radio for now. I'll take the radio out, take it out of the equation, and I'm going to go back to the bare bones truck wires that need to be there, and that should, sorry if I'm making you dizzy, but that should make things a little simpler for what I'm trying to do. And then I can reinstall this radio later with, you know, proper, either crimp connects with, like, I think I mentioned before, I don't mind crimp connects. If they're heat shrunk and they're good quality crimp connect with proper, you know, crimpers, not, Harbor Freight or whatever cheesy dollar store crimpers. Like, I've got these ones that I use that are gray. They're a good brand name. They're a good crimper, but I have the actual proper ratcheting crimpers. These ones are good for like limited access and good for, I use them mostly for strippers, but the actual ratcheting ones that put a dual bite on it, they're the ones to get. So before I go any further with this stuff here, I got to clear out the shit. So the wipers, this was converted to electric wipers a little while ago. That seems to be all good. It was put in with an inline fuse. Everything's cool. So I'm going to leave that, just maybe tidy it up a bit. The cigarette lighter 12 volt thing, it's not even hooked up. It's just sitting here doing nothing. So I'm going to lose that because I want to put in a USB port. My buddy Chris Silver hooked me up with a good deal on some USB ports. So I put one in my Malibu. I'm probably going to put one in this. So I'll do that and get rid of this guy. So it's a dual USB port that's sitting here. Like, I'm not, obviously this truck isn't worried about originality. I'm not sure if I'm going to keep this head unit. It's a good head unit for its time, but the one I have in the Malibu syncs with my phone. So I play most of my music through like Spotify and stuff. So I don't really use the USB stick thing anymore. I thought that was a CD player. It's not even a CD player. It's just a USB one. So I don't, maybe, no, but my phone doesn't. Now I'm thinking out loud, my phone doesn't have any auxiliary ports. So I need it to Bluetooth and that doesn't Bluetooth. So I might lose that. They're getting cheap now. They used to be like, I remember in high school, you'd pay like $600 for a good deck. Now it's like 80 bucks. So that's that. I got to keep working on cleaning and straightening out stuff as I go. I know this isn't part of the LS swap, but it is definitely part of the truck project. So I'm going to go ahead and remove the radio and the wiring that goes with it, and I'll start from scratch with that. Okay, so I have some stuff straightened up. Still a giant mess, but I'm working on it. So, I've mounted my OBD. So that's where that's gonna live. Let me get a light. There, now you can see. That's where that's gonna live. And the nice thing about that is then this just goes on top and it'll be nice and tidy and you won't even tell. So this is the one that goes to the PCM, the positive and negative, the ground and the 12 volts I gotta get to it are right here. I've soldered, heat shrunk, and wrapped them around. So I've checked to see where I have my battery hooked up, by the way. Checked to see that I have full constant voltage there. So I think that's probably the spot that I'm gonna use to plug in my OBD port. And I'm just gonna find a good spot to ground it. The other thing I was checking to see what has power with ignition on and power without. Interesting thing that I have to do is, not interesting, but something I have to do. This is a 12 volt for the brake switch for the torque converter lockup. I believe that's what it's for. So this has to go to positive side of the brake switch. On the brake switch on this truck is right here. So this one is not energized. This side is energized, 12 volts all the time. And then when you push the brake pedal, let's see if I can do this without dropping everything. You can see I've got positive there. I've got the light, woohoo, and nothing, right? But then you push on the brake pedal and you can see it lights up. Hopefully you can see. So what's that? What that's doing is when you push on that, it's completing the circuit and sending power to your brake lights. So the spot where it gets 12 volts all the time is where I have to tie this guy in. So I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna pull that guy off, probably do like a change that butt splice connector, not butt splice, spade connector, and put the two wires in the back, give it a proper crimp with some heat shrink, and I'll put that in there. And that's done. This is done. Really, I'm down to cruise control wiring that has to come in the cab, which I have a plan for, but haven't done yet because I keep procrastinating on it forever. It's gonna be, I swear it's gonna be the last thing I do. Yeah, so, and then I've got to mount this little box here somewhere, run this to the OBD and tie wrap that all up nice and tidy. I have to run power to this. I think that it doesn't get, I have to read the instructions, but I don't think it gets constant power. I think it gets ignition power, but I'll let you know. So I've got to run power to it. I already ran the what is that, fuel sender wire. I have to put a ground on that as well, so I need a good common ground point. So I'm gonna put a couple spots underneath there that I could put a bolt through or something and make a nice common ground point, because I have to ground this box as well as ground for the sender. I have to ground this OBD port. I have to ground everything. Gotta get grounded. So I'm gonna work on that probably next. I don't sound very confident in that decision, but I'm going to continue doing something. But that's where I'm at right now. This is the OBD interface that makes it so I don't have to put wires into every single one of these ports. I just plug it in with this little fancy connector, and this little other fancy connector goes into my OBD, and it reads everything from the computer. So it should get oil pressure, it should get water temperature, should get a tach, should have my cruise control, should have my gear selector. Not sure what else. Check engine light. It should have all those things. It's even got a mod that I can add to it later for, like, if I want a compass signal on it, so I can have the compass working, or temperature, like external temperature. The only thing is, the only problem with that is that I'm in Canada and my gauges are in Imperial, because that's what was available. So it won't be in Celsius, it'd be in Fahrenheit, which is fine. I don't really care. which also means my speedometer is going to be in miles an hour, which I also don't really care. It was in miles an hour from factory anyways. So I've got this all wired in now. The interface for the OBD port is in, power is in, grounds are grounded. This nice thing about this is it's just a Cat 5 cable that goes up to the gauges. You don't have to wire everything on the back of the gauges, which is a pain in the ass. So that's nice. And just plug it in. All the wiring connections are down here. I'm not sure if maybe I have to wire in something for my brake lights, or maybe a high beam, low beam switch, or something like that if I want it to work on the gauge. But all those ports are kind of down here. They're accessible. I can get at them later if I have to, but I should have everything wired up enough to make the gauges work at this point. But I got to put them in the bezel so I can install it. So I have to take everything out of this bezel. But I think that says 1956. And then follow the instructions and put this in this bezel so I can install it. And then I can look at putting it in the dash. I've got comes with some foam and some screws and a whole lot of instructions on stuff to do. Look at the mess. Brian here broke my equipment. So he's fixed it. He fixed it. He's still got a lot of mess to clean up. He made me my gas hole to go on my gas hole in this fancy fire pit thing. Anyways, this is where I'm at. I have a giant mess. But things work. Pedals installed. I had to run wires for my, what is this stuff? The lights for when my headlights are on, my left signal, right signal, high beam switch. So when I turn this thing on and it does all this cool stuff, turn the headlights on, and then signals work, high beam switch works, and and you can hear my fuel pump, voltmeter works, so says I'm low. It's not enough volts. Yeah, getting closer. I still have a whole bunch of mess to clean up, and but everything works. Everything works now. So that's something. My wipers work. Wipers work. Heater fan. Horn doesn't work because it's disconnected under the hood. And you can see where I mounted everything. That's nice and tidy. I put the kill mat or whatever it's called behind my pedal because ultimately the whole interior is going to be done with that. I have to get rid of these dash lights and this power here and then continue cleaning up my wiring, but the dash part is done. Check engine. There probably is one. So
for those of you silly enough to stick with me throughout this whole video, I said I sold a car. I'm going to show you what I sold. I guess I'll show you the mess that's on this storage side of my shop here. It's pretty crazy. It's going to get crazier because I bought another car and it has to come home. And I don't really have a place to put it, so I got to figure that out. Okay, so this is the storage side of my shop. My 64 coupe is leaking transmission fluid, so that's not ideal. New engine and everything was all resealed. I resealed everything and I'm gonna have to pull it out again to replace torque converter seal. But that happens, it's not a big deal. 55 is sitting over there. The bug is very much part. Update coming on this soon. The engine upgrades are done and the transmission is almost done. I'm picking that up soon. Ramp side's just hanging out on the battery tender. Malibu has been, it's covered in dust, but it's sitting here as my LS swap example. I LS swapped this, I guess a year ago now. So some of the things that I did on this, I did on the truck. So I've been kind of using that as a template. Model A hanging out in the corner. Jacob's 65 up top there. That's my son's car. And it's, I guess that's also his car underneath, the Fox body. This car I sold. I bought it late last year, thinking I was going to keep it for myself. And I stumbled across something different. So not everything can stay, something has to go. So my buddy Richard bought this. It's actually a really nice car. It's a 66 Corvair Corsa. It's a 140 car. This is an Oshawa built one. I think there's like under 600 of them, 580 some odd or something like that. I'm not sure the exact number that were built in Oshawa for 66. This is one of them. It was originally like a lemon wood yellow. Somebody painted it this nice green. I was going to do a walk around on it before. People have asked for that and I haven't done it, but now it's going. So I guess I'll do it quickly now. Interior's nice. Headliner's great. Corsa has the Corsas are all four speed. They all have this gauge cluster. They came in two engine configurations, a 140 and a turbo. This one's the 140 four carb, 65 and six only. It was kind of the top model. So this is a pretty cool car. It had some stale gas in it, so Richard drained it out. My buddy Dave built me some carbs. Richard's been putting the carbs on it. So it's going to a good friend of mine, and I have faith that he'll look after it and treat it as it should be treated. It's going to a really good home, so that's good. And I look forward to cruising with him. Look forward to seeing it out. It doesn't need very much, just some maintenance from sitting around because it's been sitting around a little while, but it's a pretty good car. So that is going. Yeah, everything else is staying. The wagon is where the wagon is. Okay, thanks everyone for watching. Please check out my other videos. Please consider subscribing. It does help the channel. Comment. Make sure you say a comment or two. It's nice to know that you're out there. We've got a pretty tight community on this channel. Coming up on 4,000 subscribers at this point, almost 100 videos. I'm pretty happy about that. I'm enjoying what I'm doing, showing you guys what I'm working on. I'd be working on this stuff anyways. I'm not putting on any show or anything. I'm just showing you what I'm doing. So thanks for watching.
please check out the other videos, and take care.